Well, our next guest is the breakout star playing the king of rock and roll.
Elvis Presley. He was the hip-thrusting singer straight out of Memphis and, arguably, the greatest entertainer that ever lived. Well, you ain't nothing but, you ain't no friend of mine, you ain't nothing but. Now, 45 years after his death, Elvis's legacy is reborn, thanks to the ultimate showman, Baz Luhrmann, who's enlisted Hollywood heavyweights to bring the king to life.
We are two odd lonely children, reaching for eternity.
Tom Hanks is formidable as Elvis's manager, but we're all shook up about newcomer Austin Butler. You may go to college, you may go to school. After auditioning in a bathrobe, Butler steps into those famous blue suede shoes in a career-defining performance.
I need to get back to who I really am.
And who are you, Oz?
Phenomenal. The incredibly talented Austin Butler joined us at the desk earlier. Please welcome Austin. Welcome to the show. Welcome back to Australia. You've made the rookie era of an afternoon nap with hectic jet lag. How do you know what day it is?
I don't. What day is it today?
It is Sunday.
It is Sunday. Okay, all right, that's
good. A lot of excited people to see you here in Australia, but a 12-minute standing ovation, I think, in Cannes. Was it that long? Did you put the stopwatch on?
I thought about it beforehand, but I did not set my stopwatch. So thankfully, somebody else was timing that. It was the most magical night of my life, really, because I hadn't seen the film before, and I'd never been to Cannes. And so getting to finally see this film that we'd spent the last 3 years working on, and it was just magic.
You hadn't seen it before that premiere?
No, everybody else had, but I waited. Because I thought, you know how special to get to see it for the first time with all these... in a darkened theatre and what an iconic place to see it. So, and I'm glad I did because the reception at the end was so special to me.
Well, congratulations on movie. Congratulations on the role. Is it... can you tell us why you auditioned for the role in a bathrobe, though?
I'll never live that one down. I didn't even think about it, really. I was trying to find my way into how I would want to approach the character. And I had filmed something a couple days prior. I'd filmed myself singing Love Me Tender. And I watched it back and I couldn't send it because I just saw an impersonation. Hmm. And it was all the external things, you know? And then I had this nightmare a couple nights later that brought up a lot of grief of something that had happened in my life. And in that moment, it was that thing where you know where you like wake up in an awful place and you think, today's just going to be an awful day. Mm. But in that moment, I thought, I'd been obsessing so much about Elvis that I thought, what would he do with this? And he would put it all into music. And so for me, I ended up singing Unchained Melody in this bathrobe because I'd just woken up. So my hair was a mess and I sat down at the piano. And there was something that was pivotal in that moment for me as far as how I would want to approach it, because what fascinated me was all the moments that we didn't see of Elvis. The moment when he just woke up, the moment when he was experiencing stuff that he didn't get to experience in front of a camera. And so that became the bedrock on which I built the rest of the
amazing
experience, you know.
The pressure to play Elvis Presley, the biggest rock star in the world, is enormous.
A little bit of pressure.
Right. You nailed it, we saw it. How deep did you have to go to portray this character? Because we watched the film, obviously you go somewhere, but what was your process?
Essentially, I didn't live any other life for 2 years. You know, I didn't see my family or my friends for that whole time. And I didn't intend for it to be that long, but you know, with COVID and our pre-production and filming all got extended for many reasons. And so it ended up being 2 years that I was working on it. Wow. And I just followed my curiosity and tried things, and some things wouldn't work, and then other things helped me find keys in his humanity. And so it was just this constant every day. But it was honestly, like, the pressure is so intense that I woke up every day around 3 or 4 in the morning with my heart pounding for 2 years. And I mean, I'm running on a few hours of sleep right now, but this was kind of me for 2 years. So just because it was like that, you just feel the weight of it every day, and you just want to do him justice and his family justice.
Can I ask, how much of the singing and the guitar playing was you? Because the whole thing looked like it was totally you.
Oh, yeah. I never actually asked Baz about where the specific moments are. I prepared for it all, and because his voice changes a lot over the years, so I tried to get as specific as I possibly could with how his voice changes. And I know that from the very outset, we knew that the 50s was going to be me, because I was recorded on acetate. It's all mono. We couldn't use that in the film. And then getting around 68 into the 70s, it starts merging our voices a bit. But I don't know where, because I can't tell where my voice is ending and his voice is sort of merging in. And so, yeah, it's. I mean, what a person to have your voice merged with. I've got to pinch myself every day.
There is so much, I suppose, excitement about you in this role. It is absolutely amazing. Is the phone running hot at the moment with offers and, you know, whatever is going to come next?
Yeah, I just feel so fortunate right now, because I'm at this place where the people that I'm getting to, you know, collaborate with are people I've admired for so long. And yeah, I'm excited to see what we get to do.
Well, it's a pleasure to meet you. The movie is out Thursday, June 23. Would you please thank Austin Butler? Thank you.